Hello and welcome to State of the Union. I'm Stefan Grobe in Strasbourg. We don't normally start this program with the weather, but Central Europe was battered by so much torrential rain and deadly flooding that it pushed everything else to the back burner this week. At least 21 people were killed in four countries when Storm Boris dumped up to five times the average September rainfall on parts of Austria, the Czech Republic, Hungary, Poland and Slovakia in just 4 days, turning entire regions into disaster zones. Towns and villages were devastated. Hundreds of thousands were forced to evacuate. National authorities considered emergency funds for the affected areas, and the European Commission in Brussels was also wondering how the EU can support them in repair and reconstruction, knowing that extreme rainfall becomes more common and intense.
This topic will be of growing importance. So this is something where we really have together as Europeans to decide how we can manage and finance the growing need of adaptation and repair that we will see in the years to come.
Working for environmental resilience and transforming Europe's economy into a competitive industrial might of the future will be the task of the new EU Commission that Ursula von der Leyen presented this week. A large chunk of that task will land on the desk of one of her top nominees, Spain's Teresa Ribera. Her portfolio was named Clean, Just and Competitive Transition.
I am very thankful for this invitation to get such a big responsibility that tackles the economic and industrial challenges for the European business community and the green challenges that do define how important is to take into consideration all the elements together.
When von der Leyen announced her new team of commissioners, she reassured reporters that climate change still dominates the Commission's agenda, together with competitiveness and security. To discuss all this, let's bring in Susanna Karp, Deputy Executive Director of Cleantech for Europe. Welcome to the program.
Thank you very much, Stefan. Happy to be here.
So at the core of the European economic power is the Green Deal, setting the framework for industries and jobs. Does the new composition of the EU Commission reflect that?
Absolutely. If anything, the composition of the new European Commission confirms the policy objectives set by the EU Green Deal, but looks towards competitiveness as a compass in asking the question, how are we going to transform our European economy? And in the way the portfolios have been allocated, we can see quite a clear vision as to how this will happen. What's at the core of this vision is how are we going to turn our early leadership in industrial decarbonization into long-lasting competitiveness and leadership for Europe on the global scene. So in that regard, I would say the portfolios are very telling. So indeed, where we are right now is moving from the if the Green Deal survives or not to how are we going to make it happen. And it's quite a comprehensive strategy, I would say, cutting across multiple portfolios. So effectively, the Green Deal has been mainstreamed into a new economic vision, a new economic doctrine.
The center of gravity of the new European Parliament has shifted to the right. Are you worried that the Green Deal could be undermined or at least watered down?
No, I don't have this concern, certainly not after having read the mission letters, because what we're seeing is that the objectives are upheld and in some regards even strengthened. This is quite clear when the reference to the 2040 climate target for the EU is mentioned in the letter to Commissioner Hoekstra for climate net zero and clean growth. So the direction is quite clear, I would say. I don't think there is any possibility of backtracking.
The Draghi report was criticized by some for lacking the boldness to really drive the transition towards a green industrial policy. What's your take?
Interesting. I thought the analysis of the report was extremely accurate, and perhaps the lack of boldness you're referring to is compensated by the bold vision of this European Commission. And so I guess, and I think this was the original idea, that the two go in tandem. What the Draghi report offers is an extremely sobering analysis of where Europe is situated vis-a-vis its global counterparts. And it goes into the reasons for that, right? So what's needed now, I think, is the member states, the council and the parliament to endorse this bold vision. And to also be committed to do what it takes for us to actually secure our long-term competitiveness as Europe.
All right, Susanna Karp, Deputy Executive Director of Clean Tech for Europe. Thanks for coming on the show today.
Thank you so much.
We started the show with an unusual segment about the weather, and we want to finish it with another one, this time about sport. The 10th edition of the British Open in speed golf took place in Ascot. Speed golf is an alternative golf format that adds a more athletic element to the normally easygoing game, and it's getting increasingly popular. The tournament encapsulated the very essence of sport with an inclusive field of golf pros competing alongside amateur golfers, women and juniors. Players were set off at 4-minute intervals with the aim of finding the sweet spot between pace and performance to maximize both. The fastest 18-hole round was under 24 minutes. The whole field of 56 players ranging in age from 12 to 58 got their rounds finished in under an hour. The winner was a 33-year-old amateur from London who later said he put in the best performance of his life. Getting interested? The next big event is the World Speed Golf Championships, hosted by Japan in November. That's it for this edition. I'm Stefan Grober. Thank you for watching. Have an excellent week.